Health segment, as we have every Tuesday. This morning we focus on cerebral palsy, and we thank you for staying with us. Joining me in studio for this discussion is Dr. Consolata Mwangi, who's a general physician. She's now on my extreme left, and also with us is Stephen Muga, who's an occupational therapist. Thank you both for joining us. I'll begin with you, Stephen, just to understand what your occupational therapist, your title, what does that mean? What does one do?
Occupational basically is a client-centered health profession that deals with persons with physical disabilities, mental, and children with developmental delays and learning disabilities, so that they're able to live a healthy and well-being life. And in that, we ensure that these children are able to function in any aspects of their life, be it in school, be it in play, and be it in socializing with their peers.
Okay. Yes. And we'll get to see how that then plays into our topic of discussion this morning. Dr. Mwangi, when we say cerebral palsy, what are we talking about?
When we say cerebral palsy, we are talking about a disorder of movement. It may also affect posture, it may affect balance. The cause is normally a damage or an insult in the brain that occurs in an immature brain. This is normally like in our setup, we see it like during deliveries, that's when you get the insult. And I must add that this damage is normally permanent.
Okay, so it's irreversible.
It's irreversible and does not normally, the good thing, it doesn't worsen, it doesn't also get better.
Okay. Mm-hmm. When you say it doesn't get better, though, we see a lot of therapy. So therapy is in vain.
Okay. What I mean, the insult in the brain, the damage in the brain remains the same. Yeah. But what is gets affected is the muscles, and the occupational therapists are able, or the people who help them, they are able to work on them and improve functionality of it. So you can, but the lesion still remains.
Okay.
It's not that
so
you
it's an issue.
You cannot
brain?
Improve the lesion itself. Yes,
okay.
It's in the brain.
It's in the brain.
Yes.
And what causes that?
There are several causes. You may have the causes. You can divide them into three. You may have what can happen before birth, an insult before birth, during birth, the process of birthing itself, and some few cases is slightly after that. So before birth, like some of them may be like infections, which luckily we don't have that here, like German measles. In our setup, what we see is mainly accidents occurring in the process of giving birth, prolonged labors, where the child lacks oxygen, they end up, that lack of oxygen is the one that causes the damage in the brain. Mm-hmm. Or sometimes, in some cases, you may have the placenta separating early before the child is already out that causes. A few cases you may have like trauma, like immediately after birth, because like we said, it's a damage to an immature brain.
Okay. Yes. So, and you come in then after this happens. But sometimes I imagine the parents who don't even realize it's cerebral palsy, their children are perhaps just not hitting those milestones as they should.
Yeah.
So break it down for us how it is most parents come to figure out, or some of the concerns they have early on.
Okay, most parents come to realize that their children are having problems when they actually are not able to attain the developmental milestones according to their age. Let's take, for example, a child who is 6 months old. This is a child that we expect developmentally that this child should be able to be sitting. But that's the time that you parents realize, oh, something is wrong with my child. He or she is not able to sit. He or she is not able to hold his or her head upright. So that's the point that they seek the attention of the medical person, or they can come directly to an occupational therapist, and they'll explain the circumstances. And once they come to us, we do an in-depth assessment just to be able to establish what could have caused this in relation to what Dr. Ria said.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then from there, we are really able to gauge out and see this insult occurred in the brain, and now it's showing up on the limbs. This child is not able to sit, not able to control his or her head, not able to move the hands and so on, and that's when we now get to develop a treatment plan for these children and move with them onwards.
So before we get to the treatment plan, we're talking about those development milestones. So other than not able to perhaps move their hands properly, can you highlight a little bit more of those things that a parent can look out for?
Some of the things that a parent should look out for and basically query that the child could be having some problem. Mostly at 3 months, we expect that this child should be having a social smile. Mm-hmm. When you look at this child as a parent, he or she should be able to smile back to you. And at around 6 months, I've talked about sitting. This child should be able to sitting independently or even just trying to sit with very, very minimal support. Others will be rolling at about 4 months, and at around 8 or 9, they should be standing up and like trying to move around with the tables, with the assistance of the tables. Mm-hmm. And mostly in the African setup, by around 12 months to around 14 months, mm-hmm. we expect that these children should be actually walking.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it's important to be able to check on
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it's very, very important to check
so
on that.
So, Dr. Mwangi, you're saying that it's pretty much when it has happened, it cannot be reversed. So it's about now management.
It's actually management.
Okay.
And its management is actually supportive. What happens is, like, these children, they are normally, it's a multidisciplinary approach. Mm-hmm. It's not normally like one person who handles them.
Mm-hmm.
You'll find that these children, they need an occupational therapist, what you were saying. Mm-hmm. They want to improve their functionalities. You may find some are having so much stiff joint, they may need a physiotherapist to work on that. Others, they may have compounding problems,
mm-hmm.
like they may be having convulsions, and that they need like a pediatric neurologist to be able to work on that. Occasionally, when the problems are so much, like stiff joints, they may need even surgery.
Mm-hmm.
Orthopedic surgeons come in. It's a multi-speciality approach.
Okay, so and it's not one size fits all.
Yeah,
yes, and even counselors, they come into the family, they need mm-hmm. to talk to the family members, what mm-hmm. they are having and what to expect. And the management is normally long term.
Mm.
It's normally a short term thing.
Okay. Yeah. So then this means for a parent it's an in and out of hospital kind of an engagement with the occupational therapist or coming at home. There's no way for a parent to with their child manage these things at home. Can they learn and do all of these exercises or whatever it is you
Yes. Generally, and as Dr. Consolata has mentioned, that it's a multidisciplinary approach, and most of the time you'll find that the parents will be walking in and out of hospitals here and there. But I just want to highlight one of the programs that we have at Feed the Children, is whereby we have a residential program where we are able to take these children through a series of rehabilitation activities, physiotherapy, occupational therapy, and orthopedic services. And we've designed this program in a way that at the end of every month, we bring in all these parents together, and we're able to train them on the skills, on how they're able to handle these children, be it at home, be it wherever they will be, even in school. And we also work very closely with the teachers so that they also be able to handle the children. And so for us, it's all about empowering the mother or the father of this child to be able to also carry out these programs or activities for the child, because it can be so overburdening. You're walking in and out of hospital every day, seeing several other specialists here and there.
Yeah.
And so it's very, very good to also have this knowledge, because it is going to help you, your child, realize his or her potential very, very quickly, but depending on the severity of the brain damage as well. So,
for most parents, doctor, when they find out, you know, that this is, you know, what their children are suffering from, how is that usually like, and perhaps you've been able to be in those moments when you're breaking the news to parents? How do most of them handle that?
First of all, there is normally denial.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody does not want to accept that that the child has a lifelong condition which they have to live with. They are looking for a quick solution.
Mm.
Like this child is having delayed milestones, is not walking at
mm-hmm.
This time. We fix that and everything is okay. But depending on the severity of the problem, sometimes you have very mild ones, sometimes even they can even be diagnosed late, like even after 3 years, like maybe you notice it's just the writing, the fine motor skills that the child is not having. But others, it's so severe such that even the speech is not coming. And once they realize that it's not something that can be fixed quickly, sometimes they're annoyed. They're annoyed with the doctors who handled them during labor. somebody who delayed them, there is a nurse, they try to blame the society, they are trying to blame everyone before they come into terms with all those. And it's also a frustrating thing because, like you're saying, you'll be working today, you're going to, like, maybe other place is good because at least it's one place center. But if you don't have a center where you're having all that, you'll have, like, today you're working to a speech therapist, tomorrow you're going to see another one like that.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So it takes a toll on parents and hence perhaps a need for counseling.
Yeah. There's need for counseling and it's very, very important, and I would call upon, like, those people who are working with such children and even parents to institute rehabilitation counseling as one of the aspects when it comes to managing cerebral palsy, because once you're able to take this parent through about this condition, and I think they're able to accept, that's the beginning point of healing. Yeah, so it's very, very, very critical.
Okay, yeah. And we just want to invite our viewers at home this morning, you're watching, listening to the conversation, perhaps some of those things being mentioned by the guests, ring a bell if you have a question or a contribution. Like to share your experience with us, feel free to engage. We'll have our phone lines numbers on your screen. Our phone lines will be open. You can call in and engage with us this morning. We'd love to hear from you. Doctor, so what then becomes the danger of not catching this and thereby starting the process of managing early on? What are the dangers of that?
Actually, in cerebral palsy, the earlier the diagnosis, the better, and the earlier the intervention, the better the outcome. The more you delay, the more you delay, the harder it becomes to improve the functionality of the children. Yes.
So if it is delayed, it becomes harder, you say. Do ever, when it's caught really early and diagnosed early, can a person fully then be okay, normal?
We have a lot of people who have cerebral palsy, and some of them have been proved like to near normal. To near normal functionality, and it was like mild to moderate with the early intervention. As we are saying, when the brain is still young, it's actually also the best time now to try and mold it, to try and fit in the things that are supposed to come in. If you want to start speech therapy, the earlier you start it, the better. Like if you start on a child, like you know, by the time people notice like there's a problem maybe with speech, that's around maybe like around 2 years. If you start early, it's better than if you had to wait like the time the child is already 5 years, when they have already lost all those milestones. Actually, what the occupational therapists try to do, the speech therapists and all that, they're trying to make them catch up with their peers as close as possible. And it's possible.
Okay, and you get to work with these kids. So for you, the earlier it is they come to you, the easier.
Yeah, the earlier they come to us, the easier. And as she has mentioned, the severity actually will actually help us to gauge more. And when you have moderate to very, very mild forms of cerebral palsy, and when you begin that early stimulation, early intervention programs with these children, you find that in the long run, you are really able to achieve a lot with these children in wherever setup they will be. And it's quite amazing, but because you'll realize most of them will even be able to attend even the mainstream schools.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because so one of the things is that usually they will not be able to.
Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah,
are
yeah,
special
yeah,
schools.
Yeah. Yeah, there are special schools around which cater for these children, and their learning is very, very modified and special in a way, so that they're really able to understand to their level of capacity, and also just to ensure that these children remain as self-reliant as possible.
Okay.
Yes.
So, doctor, if not diagnosed early, can this lead to permanent disability?
Of course. If it's not diagnosed early, or even like you have some parents that like they would want to hide their children, they're not seeking out treatment, they notice the child is having all this, so what they do, some of them, they lock them in the houses. What you'll have is you'll have like some of the things that if the child was at this level, you find them are actually going backwards. And some of the things that can develop, like you were talking about, is stiff joints, they get, they're even developing contractures, and this is something that could have been worked on and improved, and they continue doing their tasks very well. So you'll find their muscles, their joints are getting weaker and poorer.
Okay. So then this sounds like for a parent who does not have means for those lower class mm-hmm. parents. It's a struggle then to do this because I imagine the special schools will cost money, to have an occupational therapist, to doing all of this will cost money. So mm-hmm. what do most resort to?
The government still has the government still has some special schools that cater for them, which are located in different neighborhoods. If somebody searches, they will find one in there.
There are those special schools, as she has mentioned, and also it calls upon communities also to come up with very affordable and tailor-made programs for such children, so that they're able to access the vital therapy programs that they would like to receive, to ensure that they are independent in life. Also, just to add on that, I think the government also has some safety net programs whereby if a parent is having a child with cerebral palsy or any form of disability, then I think there's some little money they are given to be able to support the family at the basic level and also at the school level.
So other than that therapy, is there medication that usually is given?
There is medicine that is given, but it's not per se to treat the cerebral palsy.
Mm-hmm.
The mainstay of treatment for the cerebral palsy is the multidisciplinary approach I was talking about.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But there are cases where medication is needed, like if there's something compounding like convulsions, convulsional seizures, or also sometimes they are having so much TV joints and they get something that's a muscle relaxant such that it helps their joints and their muscles not to be so stiff such that they can do something, but it's not the mainstay. Now the other things that come in is like, okay, some of them may also have hearing problems, now they'll see the ENTs, now who are called, they may be put on hearing aids.
And you imagine in this day and age, you know, there's so much technology and advancements in so many areas. Is there any work going towards figuring out a cure, solution, a way to turn this around?
Yes, there's a lot of research going on. There's something called stem therapy. The US and actually the Chinese are doing a lot about it, and there is promising, there's a lot of hope.
So break that down for us, stem therapy.
Stem therapy, okay, stem cells is like when a child is born, they have a lot of like undifferentiated cells. Those cells can be taught to behave like the liver cells, the brain cells. They can form any part of the body. So there's a way that they can get harvested, and when they harvested, like what people prefer is like maybe for the same family, so that because of ethical issues, these are cells that can like be put back on a person who's suffering on the same family, and then they help. Like we say, the problem is the brain, like to repair now that part that is damaged. Is still a lot of work going on.
Okay, but there is some work. So for me, it's because I imagine in these kind of conditions, you talked about many parents being in denial when they first find out. So I imagine all kinds of tales around, you know, children with various conditions. What are some of those that we can debunk this morning?
Yeah, some of the myths that we can debunk on this morning is most parents believe that their children have been bewitched. Yeah, and when you move into different communities, there are all sorts of myths that is associated with disability. And being cerebral palsy being one of the main leading forms of disabilities within children. So most parents actually believe that their children are bewitched. Others will talk of their caste. Others will think that either one of the spouses has brought the whole issue into the family, and you see it brings out a large number of things. Even it leads to separation and even divorce.
Are there any others, or those are some of the ones you've heard about?
People blame everything, even say some maybe dowry was not paid. Others will say it's a punishment from God. You see them, they did this, now God is punishing them. And there is a lot of stigma when you're having a child with special needs.
But there is no genetic component associated with cerebral palsy, is there?
It's acquired. It's not genetic, it's acquired.
It's acquired.
It's acquired, yes.
Okay. So for these children, can they live a normal life? For many parents, they'll be like, okay, so we've caught this, diagnosed it early on.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a normal life, or will they forever be dependent on other people?
This will basically depend on the severity of the brain damage and the severity of the cerebral palsy. As we've talked about mild to moderate, those ones we believe they can actually live a near normal life. But those with the very severe forms of cerebral palsy, they'll actually be dependent on somebody to take care of of them. But the main issue or the main objective for these therapies and the multidisciplinary approach into the treatment of cerebral palsy is to ensure that this child actually lives a more meaningful life. We want to see this child not being locked into the houses. We want to see this child being able to socialize and play with the other peers, however disabled they are. Could it be maybe they're on a wheelchair or using any other form of mobility aid? We really, really want them to go out there and participate as others so that they can see life as something really meaningful to them, and also be able to just play, interact, and even be with others.
Yeah. So when you're doing some of that therapy, for example, if it's a speech issue, so when it's diagnosed early, is it possible to regain full speech?
It will depend at
again with the
with
level.
The level,
so
and
yeah,
and part of the brain that is injured, because we also do have the speech centers within the brain. So if that is injured, then basically the speech might not come out clearly. But what we are saying is you need not to speak for you to be able to communicate. You can communicate through other forms. I can have a picture card and I tell you, Sophia, I need this. I just flash it on your face.
And you communicate. Daktari, there's also, you know, I imagine some parents who would think if it's a brain issue, we've heard of brain surgeries, why can it not be fixed? What do you tell those kind of parents?
Actually, that's what they do. They come to the hostels, and some they have the money, they have this special child, and they are asking you, as we are, we want to support the child to the highest level possible. Is there a center in the world where we can take them? They get operated, and they and we solve this thing. You just have to sit with them, and they, like, you go through the calls and all that, and show them it's not, the damage is not like. It's not like something sometimes you can see like this. It's microscopic. It's not like a cancer or a swelling like you can remove. The damage is at the cellular level. And most of the time, sometimes they even seek another opinion from somebody who's still trying to see whether there's another option that can be done. But with time, they come to accept, and they accept their kids. And as they see, because the good thing with this intervention technologies that are done, there's always something positive that comes out. When they start seeing something positive, oh, this child did not have hand holding after occupational therapy, oh, they can do that. This child could not sit, oh, now they can sit. Now they start getting very involved, and they are happy. You can walk along with them now at that stage.
My director tells me our time is up, so before we wrap this up, for parents who are watching this morning, what do you tell them in terms of, say, it's been a struggle, are there societies, associations they could work with? Because I always believe sometimes it's power in numbers when you're able to come together and support each other, have that support base where you're not alone and you don't feel like, you know, this is all on you. What would be your parting shot?
My parting shot to the parents is don't hide these children at home. Actually bring them out. Early intervention and early detection is very, very critical for these children, and it actually defines the progress and the long-term prognosis of the intervention for these children. So in terms of associations, there are quite a number of associations in Kenya, and also the hospitals are very, very supportive. If you walk into any hospital like Kenyatta, there is Cerebral Palsy Society of Kenya. We are also down at Feed the Children. We'll be able to actually support you and help you walk along with your child.
So at Feed the Children, you also have programs that help?
Yes, at Feed the Children, we have programs that are able to help children with cerebral palsy and children with disabilities.
Okay.
Yes.
Final word?
I would also tell them, like, to seek, you seek other parents who are having a similar experience, because it's like you get comfort and see, oh, I'm not also going through this alone. Mm-hmm. And like if you can join the Cerebral Society of Kenya now, that can be good, because you get many people to interact with and tell you how they are coping.
Okay, and that society you can find online.
Yes, yes.
It's Cerebral Society of Kenya.
Cerebral Palsy Society of Kenya.
Mm-hmm. All right, excellent. Thank you very much, Dr. Consolata Mwangi, who's a general physician, and Stephen Muga, who's an occupational therapy, with us this morning on your health, talking about cerebral palsy. We thank you very much, and we
thank
hope
you.
That information has been helpful to you at home. If you know of somebody who may be having a child that's struggling, then you know to recommend that they be able to seek out this kind of information, and that early intervention always helps in as far as helping the child have a more meaningful life. Why don't you bring in Mike? We are pretty much wrapping now, Mike.
Yes, and thank you for great information there, because what I've realized is some of this information, when you don't have it, you suffer alone, you struggle, you don't know what to do, whereas when the information is available, then you know there are all these avenues that you can get support groups.
Mm-hmm.
You are not alone as you go through some of this trying times, especially for a parent who has a young child who has something which seems not what you expected.
Indeed.
So great information right there.
Yes.
And also some good information coming in from our response on person of interest.
Mm-hmm.
And thank you so much for joining us right here on Morning Express. There are some who are quoting what Julius Yego was saying. He was saying it's not over until it's too late. I think that's paraphrased.
Yes.
I know of a saying that says it's not over until the fat lady sings, or it's not over until it's over. But there you go. Also encouraging to know that one can make, you can be what you want to be. Looking at Yego, he did not have the opportunity but took advantage of what he had. So some great response coming in.
Indeed, and that was a great interview. Really good interview, and a great guy indeed he is. So thank you very much for watching. That's where we wrap it up. Stay with KTN News, those who are there, because Michael will be back at 9 with more news. Have a lovely day. We'll see you tomorrow.